After the armistice, war films vanished from the screen. The public was sick of the subject. But in 1925 came the Big Parade. MGM were gambling that enough time had elapsed for the national mood to change. The Big Parade was the brainchild of Lawrence Stallings, a Marine veteran who had lost a leg in action. Stallings was assigned to work on the story with director King Vidor. Vidor knew little about the war and found Stallings' stories hard to accept.
So I went with him on the train, and we both had a room together. And I was sitting up in bed at the lower berth. He wanted the upper berth. And he took his leg off at night, and his wooden leg, and hung it up on a... But he'd leave the sock and the shoe on the leg, and then by the suspender part, he'd hang it up on the hook in the room. And I was sitting in bed reading a war scenes, and I thought, well, it's not all as bad as it sounds. I was saying that so I could go to sleep. And so I could sleep well. I'd say, well, I think there's some fiction about this. And the train was swaying back and forth, and the leg was swaying. And finally, the leg came over, and the shoe kicked me right in the chin. And I thought, well, it is real.
Man, played by John Gilbert, is carried away by the excitement and decides to enlist. One sequence had special significance for Vidor, the march through Belleau Wood, a walking charge towards machine guns. Vidor searched for a way to capture the basic idea he wanted the film to express, that war means death, not glory.
Well, that particular walk through the woods was done so that every move would be on the beat. Now, actually, I got that idea from watching the tempo of a funeral march in some Signal Corps film of a military funeral march. There was no sound, it was just film, but it looked like death, even though you didn't see the caisson with the flag-draped coffin on it. And I said, well, this is a good idea to keep this whole thing in a suspended tempo, in a suspended beat. Therefore, it would look like death before they got to the actual frontline trenches. And so I worked out with a metronome going back and forth. We didn't have portable loudspeakers, so we used a bass drum to let the metronome beat be heard all over the woods. And actually, to see that everybody was working on the beat, we had orchestra leaders and musicians scattered around in the troops. And it meant that you picked up the gun on the beat and pulled the trigger on the beat and put your hand up to your wound on the beat and fell on the beat and everything right on in tempo. And it, at first they laughed at it, but they're glad enough to work. And when you make them stick to the beat, they said, what is this, a bloody ballet?
was the Battle of Belleau Wood in which Stallings had lost his leg. And the same thing happens to John Gilbert in the film.
I was strictly anti-war, and I was doing as much as I could do to speak against war in that film. And it has a lot of things that we definitely thought couldn't be shown in regular theaters. And there was a period that we didn't know whether it would be shown. The tie-in between the movie producers and the government was so strong that, or the censorship haze and so forth, that if you made anything that discouraged enlistment or discouraged going to war or fighting and everything, the government would say no. And perhaps the producers would listen and obey.
The head of MGM, Louis B. Mayer, strongly objected to the homecoming scene. Audiences would be shocked to see their favorite star so mutilated. Vidor had confidence enough to shoot the scene on a Sunday and to pay the crew himself. The Big Parade enjoyed unprecedented success. It was critically acclaimed, and it made more money than any other MGM production.